Hello again as we meet together on this format for our worship service. A very warm welcome to you, wherever you might be, in your homes, in rooms with friends, overseas. It's good to have you worshiping with us. And so we're going to begin our time of worship as we read from the Psalms, Psalm 139. Hear these words from the psalmist of God's complete knowledge and care. Lord, you have examined me and you know me. You know everything I do. From far away, you understand all my thoughts. You see me, whether I am working or resting. And you know all my actions. Even before I speak, you already know what I will say. You are all around me, on every side. You protect me with your power. Your knowledge of me is too deep. It is beyond my understanding. Where could I go to escape from you? Where could I get away from your presence? If I went up to heaven, you would be there. If I lay down in the world of the dead, you would be there. If I flew away beyond the east or lived in the farthest places in the west, you would be there to lead me. You would be there to help me. I could ask the darkness to hide me or the light around me to turn into night. But even darkness is not dark for you, and the night is as bright as day. Darkness and light are the same to you. You created every part of me. You put me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because you are to be feared. All you do is strange and wonderful. I know it with all my heart. When my bones were being formed, carefully put together in my mother's womb, when I was growing there in secret, you knew I was there. You saw me before I was born. The days allotted to me had all been recorded in your book before any of them ever began. O God, how difficult I find your thoughts. How many of them there are. If I counted them, they would be more than the grains of sand. When I awake, I am still with you. God is ever present. He knows us. He's with us. All the time. Always. Let's turn to our Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for your all-consuming knowledge of us, your complete knowledge of us. We thank you, Lord, for your constant presence with us wherever we are, in whatever we're doing, and wherever we might find ourselves. You're with us, Lord, in the good times and even in the bad times. You're with us when we're soaring and riding the crest of the wave. You're with us at our deepest ebbs. When we're at our lowest, Lord, you are still there with us. We praise you, we worship you, we adore you as the God who is ever present. Thank you, Lord, for that comfort and that promise. Thank you for your presence in our lives, even, Lord, when we were not aware of it, even when we are not aware of it. And so, Lord, we ask that you would forgive us for those times when we have ignored your presence, been distracted from your presence, or times when we've tried to hide you from others. Forgive us, Lord, for all our sins, especially when we have done things, said things, or thought things that have been so opposite to the life you call us to live, to the kingdom you long to establish. We pray, Lord, that you would forgive us for all our sins. We are sorry. Forgive us, we pray. We thank you, Lord, for your promise of mercy, your willingness to be gracious, your love that goes beyond our expectations. Thank you, Lord, for your forgiveness. May we hear those words of grace. Brother, sister, son and daughter, your sins are forgiven. Lord, may we believe it, may we know it, may we feel it. And as we come to that place, so Lord, we long to be in relationship with you. Having been forgiven, Lord, there's nothing that stands between you and us. All that separates us has been dealt with through our forgiveness. Thank you, Lord, for all your blessings. And so as we turn to Scripture, as we turn, Lord, to reflect on what you have to say to us, through your Spirit, speak to us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. And so we sing together our first song for this morning. As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after you. Our second passage of Scripture comes from Luke's Gospel. I invite you to hear these words from Luke chapter 10, verses 38 to 42. A familiar story about Mary and Martha. Jesus visits Martha and Mary. Now, as they went on their way, he entered a village, and a woman named Martha received him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his teaching. But Martha was distracted with much serving, and she went to him and said, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Tell her then to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are anxious and troubled about many things. One thing is needful. Mary has chosen the good portion, which shall not be taken away from her." May God bless his reading to us. Amen. We've heard that story often, and probably most often the way it is interpreted is that they look at the personality types of both Mary and Martha. Mary, who is portrayed as the reflective, deep, quiet, silent type. And she has this natural pull towards stillness and cherishes the clarity and serenity of quiet. Martha, on the other hand, she's portrayed as the one who is busy and active, maybe achievement-orientated, but she's good at multitasking. She can prepare a meal and listen still to what's happening in the other room, and it all just works out. She's a worker of note. But for today, I want to take a look at this passage from a very different perspective. I want us to look at it from the perspective of practicing the grace of God's presence. Practicing the presence of God. So let's delve in a little bit into the story. At the beginning, Luke says that Martha received him into her home, implying that Jesus would be spending the night. Now, this was not unusual. It highlights the custom of radical hospitality that was very much part of the ancient Near East. In fact, travelers would often rely on the hospitality of private homes as they moved from one town to the next on their journey. But what is amazing is that Jesus chooses to be entertained in the home that is headed by an unmarried woman. And not only that, but that included an unmarried sister. There is also, we do know that Mary and Martha knew Jesus, and there was obviously some sort of relationship, but it still does raise some tension in the story. But it was also not necessarily normal for a rabbi to be entertained in that way. And so even if it's a rabbi being with their disciples and a rabbi having women disciples, even that creates further tension in this particular story. This then is compounded by the fact about what Luke says about Mary, that she sat at Jesus' feet. This was the technical term that was often used in ancient times to indicate the relationship between a disciple and a rabbi. To make someone your rabbi, you made a decision, a fundamental choice, to be with that person as much as possible, to learn everything that you could from your rabbi, that everything that he went through, that he taught, the way he dealt with conflict, the way he dealt with money, the way he made food, the way he prayed, the way that he lived, the disciple would be privy to all of that, would witness everything of that. If you remember Rob Bell in the Numa videos, he speaks about a blessing that you would pass on to disciples that would read, "May you be covered in the dust of your rabbi." It really is a literary compliment saying that literally, may you be so close to your rabbi that you walk so close behind them that the dust that they pick up with their sandals, that may cover you. In other words, you would listen to every prayer, every teaching, every utterance that your rabbi made. You would be witnessing every action and interaction because you would be right there, present all the time. You would be watching your rabbi's every move. And this is the choice that Mary made, to sit at Jesus' feet. And Jesus then says, just this one thing is needed. And Mary had chosen this one thing, to be at the feet of Jesus. No matter what else is going on around her, this was her choice. The fundamental decision that makes us disciples is that we need to choose to always be with Jesus. We need to continually make that choice in all that we do, that we can be fully like him, that we witness the way he lives, the way he acts, the way he speaks. We can take all that teaching, all that example into our own lives, that we may become more and more like our rabbi. Have you ever made that choice? Have you chosen to sit at the feet of Jesus? It's a choice, a fundamental choice we need to make. And here's the good news. By God's amazing grace, Jesus is present on every page of your life. Whether you recognize him there or not, whether you want him there or not, Jesus is always present. As we read in our psalm reading, God knows us. He's aware of us. Wherever we go, God is there. Jesus is always present. What if you woke up every morning and said, "Today I would like to be covered in the dust of my rabbi"? What if you repeated that same prayer all through the day? "I want to be covered in the dust of my rabbi." What if we became more aware that Jesus is present on every page of our lives? While Mary is sitting at the feet of Jesus, Martha is in the kitchen. And note what Luke says about her. Martha was distracted by all her preparations. Not too busy, not overcommitted. She was distracted. Something was pulling her away. Something dragged her away from his presence. Martha has a desire to be in the presence of Jesus. She wants to be with Jesus, but there's other stuff that needs to be done, and that is distracting her. Martha's trying, in some senses, to get rid of the dust, while Mary is wallowing in the dust. What distracts us from Jesus? Our culture? Our expectations? Other people's expectations of us? Our fear, our pride, wanting to please others. We need to be at the feet of Jesus. So let's get back to Martha. So you can imagine Martha's working hard, doing what she is doing, chores around the house. She has a guest. There are things that need to be done. And while she's busy doing all that, while she's so distracted, she's wondering when Mary will come and help her. I mean, Mary needs to come and do her bit. Why is she not coming? And Martha's getting a little bit frustrated, and so she maybe begins to bang dishes together. She begins to rattle the crockery, maybe even slam a door or two. But Mary doesn't come. And we all know what Martha is thinking. Jesus talks about service. Why doesn't Mary get it? Hello, Mary, wake up. It's time to serve. It's time to do. There's stuff to be done. We have a guest to entertain. But that's not all that troubles Martha. No rabbi has a woman disciple. What is Mary doing sitting at Jesus' feet? What will people say? What about the rumors? They didn't have social media in the time, but trust me, the gossip would have run through the town. What about the reputation of these two unmarried ladies with Jesus in their home? And so finally, Martha can take it no longer. And so she's certain that she's right. I mean, she knows what Jesus has said. And so Martha wants Mary to sort it all out her way. And so she goes to him and says, "Lord, don't you care that my sister's left me to do all the work by myself? Please tell her to come and help me." And Jesus replies, "Martha, Martha." Let's just pause there a moment. We need to watch out when Jesus uses your name twice. When Jesus uses your name twice, it means business. It means he's especially trying to get your attention. Remember 1 Samuel chapter 3? When God is calling Samuel, he says, "Samuel, Samuel," calls him twice. Luke chapter 22, when Jesus is predicting Simon's denial, "Simon, Simon," he says, I have prayed for you. You remember Acts chapter 9 in Saul's conversion, as he hears that voice from heaven, it says, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? We might have even done the same to our children or our grandchildren. When we call their name twice, we're getting their attention. And Jesus says, Martha, Martha, listen, I'm getting your attention. There is only one thing that is needed. The decision to live continually in the presence of Jesus. To be covered by the dust of your rabbi. All we need to do is be aware that Jesus is present. He is always present. He's always involved in what we're doing in every moment of every day. He is there. Martha was not doing bad things. I mean, Jesus often speaks about doing work well and even working hard. He even has stories about hard workers, and our workers get rewarded for hard work and good work. The problem is simply that Martha was not being with Jesus even in her work. She'd invited him into their home, but not into the kitchen. How often do we get so distracted with daily chores, group activities, daily demands, other people's expectations, that we forget Jesus is present in every moment? How often do we get so distracted with work demands, activities that we have to do to achieve a goal that we've set, to make it to the next meeting that we've organized, that we forget that Jesus is present in every moment? God is closer than you think. God is on every page of your life. So be aware of him in every moment, in every activity, in every circumstance and situation. This is not about trying harder or doing more. This is all about being with Jesus, being aware that Jesus is with you, sitting at the feet of Jesus. By God's grace, Jesus is always present on every page of your life. We need to practice the presence of God's grace, because God is present in our lives. In our church, we have been looking at a course on soul keeping, and this verse from Matthew chapter 11 came up, and I read it to you from the Good News Translation. It reads like this: Come to me, all of you who are tired and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke and put it on you, and learn from me, because I am gentle and humble in spirit, and you will find rest. For the yoke I will give you is easy, and the load I will put on you is light. I want to read that same passage from Eugene Peterson's translation in The Message, and then highlight just two phrases which tie in with this concept of God being present with us. Eugene Peterson writes, Are you tired, worn out, burned out on religion? Come to me. Get away with me and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me, and you'll learn to live freely and lightly. Note those two phrases. Keep company with me, says Jesus. Keep company with me in everything we do. Be aware he is present. Sit at his feet. know that Jesus is there in whatever we're going through and keep company with him as we go through all of life. Keep company with me, says Jesus. The second phrase says, learn the unforced rhythms of grace. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. As Jesus is present, recognize the grace of that moment. This God who created us is always present. Be aware that Jesus never leaves us. He's always with us as we practice the grace of God's presence. While we keep company with him, we will become aware of the unforced rhythms of God's grace, operating all the time in our lives. And so I challenge you to be a dusty disciple. Today and every day, may you be covered in the dust of your rabbi. Let us pray. Father God, in all our activity, in all that we're involved in, keep making us aware of your presence. Keep reminding us of the grace of the all-creating, all-powerful, ever-present God is with us. May we choose to sit at your feet, not only every day, but every moment of every day. And Lord, as we become aware of your presence, as we keep company with you, may we become aware of those unforced rhythms of grace. You, Lord, are present. May we choose to sit at your feet. In our activity, in the demands of life, in the circumstances we find ourselves, in the situations we have to face, in the hurdles we have to overcome, in the mountains we have to climb, may we be aware you are with us. You are present in every situation. You are present on every page of our lives. Thank you, Jesus, for the promise of your presence. Be with us, we pray. Amen. And so we sing together our final song, Saviour, thy dying love thou gavest me. We sing together.
Thank you.
And so receive this benediction as we go our separate ways. May the grace of God, the love of Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.